All right, so let's start. So this is MRI of knee, and I'll be showing some plain films. Mostly it's MRI. And anybody who is going into MSK or who is not going into MSK, they all need to know knee MRI, because whichever practice you go to, whether it's academic or private, you'll have to do some of it. So we'll go through very basic concepts in the beginning. So I'll show you a lot of anatomy slides. So when you start looking at the MR, people have a habit of going straight to the sagittal images. Use your coronal images, they're very useful. For a number of structures. So this is the first coronal image you should look for. That's the patella, that's the quadriceps tendon coming down, patella tendon coming down. So you'll see tears or contusions of patella, because whenever people fall, they fall on their patella. So you'll see the contusions right on this cut. Going further down, the femur, the tibia, and we use basic two types of sequences. One is a non-fat saturated, the other one is a fat saturated. So commonly, most of the institutes employ proton density saturated and non-fat saturated images. And I'm showing most of the structures on this, and I'll tell you where the non-fat saturated images have their role. So here, this is a proton density fat saturated image. And you can see on the side, these are the collateral ligaments. So all these ligaments are thickenings of the capsule, so they will be just abutting the capsule. So this is medial collateral ligament. We'll go over different layers later in the lecture. And that's the iliotibial band, which goes on the Gerdes tubercle. Okay. These little things are the menisci, and they are very important for the knee stability, for distribution of weight, for lubrication, for a load distribution. So basically, these are very important structures. In the middle are the cruciate ligaments. So this is anterior cruciate, and there will be posterior cruciate on this side, the medial side. So this is posterior cruciate, anterior cruciate, medial collateral ligament, lateral collateral ligament, menisci. And menisci are like C-shaped. So you have anterior horn, posterior horn, and body in the center. So when we are cutting coronals, so the horns will be long, okay? Body will be like a triangle, and posterior horn will again be long. So these are really in the body of the menisci. So this is a medial meniscus, lateral meniscus. How do you know medial or lateral? One by medial and lateral collateral ligaments. The other by, you have always more fat on the medial side. If you palpate your knees, okay, there's always more fat there. So there's a medial side, that's a lateral side. Going further down, so you have various layers to the medial collateral ligament. We'll go over that. There's a layer which comes from the muscles, vastus medialis, that's the crural fascia. This is the medial collateral ligament proper, which goes from the medial epicondyle all the way to the pes anserinus area. And then you have a deep layer, which are thickenings of the capsule, the meniscofemoral and meniscotibial. So these are the three layers of the medial collateral ligament. Okay? And now we have gone through the iliotibial band, we are more posterior. So this area basically has meniscofemoral and meniscotibial ligaments again. Okay? That gray thing is the cartilage. Yes. Yeah, we're going to go over that. So that's not meniscofemoral, that's called posterior oblique ligament. So we're going there. So you see these three structures, okay? And this is ACL, PCL, so we'll go over this anatomy further in detail, but they are basically in the center. So ACL prevents the anterior translation of tibia, PCL prevents the posterior translation. Okay, simple functions. Further going back, so now I showed you those three layers. So you have this layer of the fascia, and these layers have started fusing. Okay. So the meniscofemoral started fusing with this. The meniscotibial goes here. Okay. So now we are going posterior. So again, the horns are going to become long. Okay. And opposite appearance you will see on the sagittal images. Okay. There the horns will be short and the body will be long, just based on the anatomy how you are cutting them. So posterior horn of medial, posterior horn of lateral. Okay. We are getting into there. And now you're getting into the lateral collateral ligament complex. Okay. So again, meniscofemoral, meniscotibial, and this is a fibular collateral ligament. Again, from the lateral epicondyle, goes on the side of the fibula, not on the top of the fibula, side of the fibula. Okay. Going further back, so now they have fused. Okay. Now this is called the posterior oblique ligament, what Carl is referring to. Okay. So you don't have any more meniscofemoral, meniscotibial. This is posterior oblique ligament. So when we talk of posteromedial corner injuries and all that, when we get into that, we'll see injuries of these. Okay. Now this is the posterior horn, posterior root, and this is the posterior horn of lateral. And the posterior root. So these are different. So look at these. The posterior horn of the medial goes straight down. Okay. Posterior horn of the lateral has one slip which goes like that. Then it crosses the tibial spine and the other slip goes like that. Okay. So when we look at root tear, you look for these. So you'll always have a little gap there, but you look for tears of these fragments of the meniscus guy. Okay. And this is the biceps femoris muscles, a biceps tendon. It comes down, it joins this lateral collateral ligament, forms a conjoint, and then here goes on the side of the fibula. And this is the posterior horn of the lateral. And see how it goes up versus posterior horn of the medial, comes straight down. Okay, that's because it is attached by these are the meniscofemoral ligaments. You have Humphrey and Risberg, okay? So you can remember those names, but important is there are two ligaments there. I've seen isolated injuries of those, but at this point nobody knows what to do with them. So, but these are the ligaments which hold it up. So that's how you can differentiate these things also. And this is the second layer of the root which comes across the spine, goes down. Okay, very important to note this anatomy. We'll go over that again when we go over injuries to different structures. But there's a lot of material, so I'm going to go a little fast, okay? And you have all these slides. You can take notes, and this might be on YouTube. She's recording it, so you may visit this lecture again. Okay. Now this is a sequence which is non-fat saturated, so fat is still bright. Okay. And what do we use that for? We use that for anything which becomes black in the background of fat. Okay, fat is bright, so you look for fractures. So that'll be black in the background of fat. Look for sclerosis. What you look on plain films as white will appear black here. Look for cysts. Versus edema. Edema is usually not apparent on these unless it's a lot of edema. Okay, so cysts versus edema. You look for osteophytes because you have nice bony margins here. And more important than all of this is the internal structures, what we do MRs for, and the meniscus. Okay, so proton density has the highest signal to noise ratio. When you read physics, I'll probably take a lecture on physics. These have the most SNR. So you're looking for any signal going to the surface. So you want your images to be as sharp as possible. So that's why I use the proton density. Okay, T1 overestimates the meniscal tears and gives you a lot of blurring, a lot of synovium appears thickened, overlaps the menisci, looks like a tear. T2 underestimates, or fat saturated images underestimate, they're more specific, but they underestimate. So these are the best images for the menisci. So when you look for menisci, look in this sequence first. Okay, if you just look on fat saturated, you'll miss most of them. And then the other thing is, you look for the ACL. So these are the two bundles of the ACL, the anteromedial and the posterolateral. So you look for normal fat in between the bundles. If there is normal fat, it's normal ACL. Okay. The earliest sign of a mucoid degeneration is you lose fat there. So these are important for those two structures and the other things I mentioned. Now we go on the satchel anatomy. So quadriceps tendon has three layers, right? Rectus femoris in the front, vastus medialis lateralis in the middle. They form together one bundle, and intermedius in the back. So it has three layers. So you want to see this three-layered structure. So anytime you have quadriceps tendinosis or tears, you look for effacement of fat or edema in these three layers. Okay. There's a retro quadriceps fat pad, which is basically saturated. It's a fat-saturated image. Then you have patella, and you form enthesophytes on the anterior aspect of the patella because patella is formed as a sesamoid bone in the quadriceps tendon. So anytime there's chronic injuries or repetitive injuries, you get enthesopathic changes here. On an MR, you can actually see the acute enthesopathic changes. You can see edema there, you can see the tendon stripping of the patella. In plain films, you just see the chronic changes. And then you have the patella tendon, which goes on the sulcus at the tibial tuberosity. Okay. And you do your patella alta measurements on this section where you see the ACL, PCL. You see the patella, you take a most oblique distance like that, exclude the osteophyte, okay, and then drop a distance down where it attaches to the tibial tuberosity in the middle of that sulcus, okay. So that's how you do your patella alta measurements. So they are roughly equal, okay. So there is a standard deviation, so you go from 0.8 to 1.2, okay. If it's more than 1.2, it's alta, it's high, less than 0.8, it's low. And again, the cartilage, although you can see the patella cartilage nicely here, but it's best to see on the axial images. Trochlear cartilage is best seen on satchel images. Okay, so that's the other thing to look at. Then you look at the contours of ACL, PCL. PCL is a structure to look at here. ACL usually don't see on these structures. Okay, it's always at an angle, so you always see some signal. Only thing I look for here for the ACL is whether it parallels this line, which is called the Blumensat line. It's the roof of the intercondylar notch. If it does not parallel, then I start thinking of tears. Okay, otherwise, for individual bundles, for the attachments, I'll look on the coronal images and axial as a problem solving. And you see these little structures all the time. These are little lymph nodes. They may have fat in them, so don't worry about them. They're not tumors. They can be big also sometimes, but they have fat within them. Okay. Going further, again, quadriceps, patella tendon, there's always a little signal here, sometimes due to magic angle artifacts. So you look for thickening of the tendon. So more than 6 millimeters is usually a thick tendon. It stopped for some reason. Okay. So you look for tendinosis. Okay. So there is a plica. So there is a superior plica which goes on the top. There is an inferior plica which goes through the Hoffer's fat. You see little edema there along the plica. So that's pretty common to see. Okay. When you look for ill-defined edema, then you start making injuries of that. And then again ACL, PCL. See how much signal you see in ACL. So sagittal is not a good image to look at ACL. Going further, ACL again, okay, and same structures. So let me show you the menisci. We didn't cover that in the okay. So here, this is the most lateral image. So when you image or when you're protocoling for your center, you always want to have images from side to side all the way. So you cover the MCL, cover the LCL, okay. You don't want to miss those structures. And this is an important cut where you see this V-shaped structure. So that's LCL, so fibular collateral ligament, biceps tendon joining to form the conjoint and going on the side of the fibula. Okay, so if you don't see that V, there may be LCL injury, although those injuries are very rare. Okay. On the axial images, start on the top, so quadriceps tendon, okay, trochlear groove going down, quadriceps tendon, these are the retinaculae, media and lateral will go over those layers. Okay, so everything has two or three layers, so these are three layers going down. Okay. So here you can see these are the menisci, we are at the joint line, okay. This is the transverse meniscal ligament. So you can have other ligaments, you can have transverse meniscal anterior, you can have transverse meniscal posterior, you can have oblique menisco-meniscal anterior to posterior horn, or anterior to posterior horn like that, oblique menisco-meniscal. So there are various ligaments, various variations. Okay, but one thing you should understand, which I didn't understand when I was a resident, these are attached only at the roots, okay. They are not attached anywhere else. So you always have synovial recesses there. And when people used to do arthrography, they'll inject contrast and they'll try to elevate the menisci to look for little tears underneath those menisci. Okay, so they're only attached at the roots. Okay. All right, going down, so this is the medial meniscus now. Okay, so medial condyle is usually larger. There's more fat on the medial side. Okay, that way also you can tell. On the lateral side, this is a popliteus tendon which courses and goes on the lateral condyle. And above the popliteus tendon, this stuff is the arcuate ligament. So this ligament goes on the top of the fibula. So I was always saying side of the fibula, that's the collateral ligament. The top of the fibula is the arcuate ligament. So there is a sign, plain film sign, arcuate fracture. It basically arc of fibula comes up. That's because the arcuate ligament pulls it off. Okay, that's associated with PCL injuries. So we'll go over all that stuff. So finally, we have seen various structures. So this is in the nutshell. So you have anterior, middle, posterior images. The body is seen as little triangles, body of the menisci, anterior, posterior, cruciate ligaments, medial, lateral, collateral ligaments. So some people include the tibial band in the lateral collateral, some people don't. But we usually, when we talk of complex, we include all those three structures. Fibular collateral, biceps tendon, conjoint tendon, going on the side of fibula, going into the posterior oblique ligament, posterior horn of the medial, posterior horn of the lateral going up, okay, PCL, and then last cut, the fibular collateral ligament, conjoint tendon on the side, popliteus tendon going up, okay, that's a popliteal muscle, it goes like medial to lateral like that, attaches there on the condyle, okay. On the sagittal images, what appears as horn on the coronal images will appear as body on the sagittal, so this large one is the body, okay. That's called a bow tie. So normally you see two or three bow ties as a normal meniscus. When it gets discoid, you'll see more bow ties. We'll go over that. Okay. Then you have anterior posterior horns. These are small. Go on the other side. This is the lateral meniscus body. Okay. On the axial images, medial, lateral, transverse meniscal ligament, medial meniscus, lateral meniscus, the roots where they are attaching. Okay. And then this is the last cut. You saw the popliteus tendon, which will go up, arcuate ligament on the top. Okay. And this side, you will have this is the medial collateral ligament. There are multiple layers to it, and they will fuse. They'll form the posterior oblique ligament here. And that gets some sleeves from the semimembranosus tendon, which inserts there. That's the gastrocnemius. So in between that will be the Baker's cyst area. Okay.